There are probably many people like myself who have thousands of film negatives lying around the house. They're probably in drawers, been abandoned, not looked at for years, which is a bit of a shame. And you might be thinking it would be a good idea to digitize them. There are several reasons for this. As I say, if they've been forgotten about and not looked at, you've probably even started to forget what's even there, so memories can fade. If you can see the photos easily on your computer, it can bring back memories. It's also safer. If anything happens to your negatives, if they're lost or damaged in any way, that's all of your photos gone. If you digitize them, you can make as many copies as you want and easily share them with friends and family. So that's what this video is about. It's about making a digital archive of your film negatives. I decided to buy an Epson scanner, and to do this, I've just used the Epson Scan software that comes free with the scanner. So in the video, there's a strong Epson bias, but some of the things I say will apply to other scanners and other software. The first part of the process, and the most tricky, is putting the negatives into the holder. And a lot of people will tell you that you should wear white cotton gloves to do this. I don't personally, I just try to be careful to avoid getting fingerprints on the negative and only hold the negative by the edges. And to insert the negative using the correct orientation, you need to pay attention to this little decal down here. Now, on the edge of the film, there'll be writing and frame numbers. And what you need to do is, when you look at the negative, is make sure that the writing is back to front and that the lower frame numbers are towards this end. And what you do, you just slip it under these little lugs here and then lay it flat. And there are two slots, and each one can hold a strip of six frames. So to maximize the capacity, just use 2 6 frame strips. Now, when I was in the UK and sent my film off to be processed, it came back from the lab like this. So there were just 4 frames in each strip. And obviously, if you load 2 strips of 4 frames, that's not the maximum capacity and it's going to take longer. Now, if you've got thousands and thousands to do, it might be an idea just to cut some in half, so you've got strips of 4 frames and 2 frames, and then put them in to get the maximum capacity. Where I get them done now, in a lab in Thailand, I just tell the guy to cut them into strips of 6 frames. And once they're in the holder, you just need to put the little cover in place and that holds them flat. You just slip it in and push it down to secure all the plastic lugs. And then you're ready to go. Once the negatives are in the holder, you need to put the holder into the scanner. And we've put the 35mm negatives into slot A. So what we need to do is make sure that this lug A goes into this hole A, like so. And now we're ready to go. You will notice on the other side of the holder, there's a slot for slides. So if we were to use slides, that slot is C, so we would then need to put lug C into hole C here. But we're not, we're using 35mm negatives, so we'll turn it around again to locate lug A, and now we're ready to go. This is my scanner. It's an Epson Perfection V600 Photo. I decided to buy a flatbed scanner that could scan negatives rather than a specialist negative scanning scanner, so that I still had the capability of scanning regular documents and books. I made a video previously, so I won't say too much about it in this video, But after doing some research, I narrowed down my choice to this one and the Canon CanoScan 9000F Mark II. I love Canon products and all my photography gear is Canon. I'm sure the Canon scanner is excellent, but in the end I plumped for the Epson. Not all flatbed scanners can scan negatives. With regular scanning, the light source is underneath and shines up through the glass of the document. With negatives, because they're transparent, the light source is above and it shines through the negative. So for regular scanning on this scanner, you have this white piece in place. And when you want to do negative scanning, you have to remove this, which is fairly simple. That comes off and it exposes the upper light source. And with negative scanning, this light source is used instead of the one below, and it shines light through the transparent negative. Now that we've got the negatives in the holder and the holder in the scanner, we're ready to scan. So I've opened up the Epson scan software, and to do that, your scanner needs to be turned on. And what I'm about to say isn't a criticism of your photography, and it applies just as much to me as it does to everyone else. And when you scan in these old photos, you'll probably find that a lot of them aren't that good, and that's normal. We can't take great photos all the time. So it's probably not worth creating huge files and doing lots of processing on 100% of the images when only 10 or 15% of those images are deserving of such treatment. So what I suggest is to make this a two-stage process. The first stage is just to get everything into your computer so you can assess what you've got. You can do some sort of basic organization, and you can select the files that are deserving of more care and attention. And then the second stage will be just to take those files and spend more time doing a better job. So firstly, I'm just going to sort of cover the first stage, which is getting all the files into the computer. Epson Scan has four modes. I'll talk about the other modes later. But for this first stage, which is just scanning in all of the images on the computer to see what you can get, use the full auto mode. And as the name implies, it is fully automatic. There's no user intervention required. You're not going to get any previews. You don't need to do any cropping. The scanner and the scanner software will analyze the strips of film, automatically crop each frame and bring it into the computer, all unassisted. And it's certainly the quickest way to do this. So choose Customize, and at the top there's an option for photograph, document or film. And as I explained earlier, on the scanner there are two light sources. There's a light source below for documents and photographs and books, and a light source above for transparency films. And you need to select film so that you choose the upper light source. And there are some other options here, and these are to improve quality. And for this stage, we're not really too concerned about quality. We're just worried about getting all the images into the computer so that we can assess what we've got. We can worry about quality later. So I wouldn't recommend selecting any of these options. You can, but it's going to add time to the processing. And if you're scanning in thousands and thousands of images, it's going to be quite a lot of extra time. You'll need to decide where the files are saved. So file save settings, and you can select a folder. And what I've done, I've just set up a temporary folder called scan. So I'm going to scan everything into that folder. And then once I know what I've got, I can then set up folders with more meaningful names and then copy the images to the appropriate folder. You can also select the file format, bitmap JPEG, TIFF, PDF. I would suggest at this stage just to select JPEG, which is a compressed format to try and keep the file sizes small. If you want, you can give your file names a prefix and a starting number, and you can overwrite any files with the same name or open image folder after scanning. So once that's all set up, okay here, and now all you have to do from now on is just press the scan button, and that will do everything automatically. And once it's finished, just take the negatives out of the holder, put new negatives in, and hit scan again. This is certainly the easiest way just to get all of your images into the computer, and then we can worry about quality on specific images at a later stage. So I'm all ready to go now. I'm just going to click scan, and this will take a little while, so I'll resume the video again once the scan has finished. That wasn't quick. To scan in these 12 frames took about 9 minutes. So that will give you an idea of how long it's going to take depending on the number of negatives that you've got. When I went through the process a few years ago, it took me several days. You get into a rhythm, and it's a case of setting everything up, pressing scan, then going away to do something useful, and then coming back to change the negatives and start the process again. And this is what I was saying about not doing too much processing on the images at this stage. If you start doing a lot of processing, it's going to take even longer. And if you've got thousands of negatives, it's going to take days, maybe weeks. So all of the images I just scanned in went to this temporary scan folder. And what I did, I then made folders with meaningful names. And after I scanned images in, I moved them across from the scan folder to the folder with a meaningful name. And this really depends on you and your photos. If your photos are mainly people, then maybe you can make folders with people's names. Most of my photos were to do with travel. I used to travel a lot. So what I did, I made folders with country names, and for those countries where I've been to several locations, I made subfolders. So for example, for the USA, I made subfolders for all these places. So if I go into California, you can see my photos from California, Charlotte, Chicago, Colorado. This works for me. It's a method where I can find photos fairly easily. You just need to choose a method that works best for you. As you're scanning in images, you need to make a note of the images that you really like so that you can scan them in again using higher quality settings. You can just use a notepad and pencil, or if you've got appropriate software, you can use it. For example, if you've got a copy of Adobe Bridge, and if you like this photo, you can just put a label on it, select, and then later on, you'll just be able to bring up all of the photos that you've selected. It'll be an easy way to find them. At this stage, you should have all your negatives scanned in and organized into folders. And to do that, we used full auto mode because that's the quickest way and it doesn't require any user intervention. The second stage is to take your best images and scan them again, this time using higher quality settings. And for that, we're going to use home mode or professional mode. The mode we're not going to use is office mode. This is really for a work environment, and it's designed for text documents, and I also think it supports scanners with auto feed, but it's not really appropriate for photos. With home mode, you need to select your document type, color negative film. This is so that the scanner uses the upper light source and shines the light through the negative and not upwards. Image type, color. Resolution, screen is 96, printer is 300, or other, we can choose our own resolution. The higher the resolution, the more detail in the image and the larger the file size. And here we have some image adjustments. So if your photos are faded, there's a color restoration. Backlight correction, I believe, removes shadows if there's too much backlight. And digital ICE technology, this is digital image correction and enhancement, so that will remove dust and scratches. Now, each of these things, they add processing and they add time to the scan. And this is why I suggested not using them when you initially scan in all your negatives, because to do all this processing on every single frame will take, it will take forever. But once you've selected specific images to do a better quality scan, then you can use these adjustments. You can adjust your brightness and contrast. And when you're all ready, you hit preview, and this will give you a preview. And once you've selected what you want, you can then do a scan. This will take a few minutes, so I'll just stop the video and then come back when it's finished. There are two tabs, normal and thumbnail, and I haven't found normal to be very useful, so I just stick on thumbnail. And you can have large thumbnails, small thumbnails, or just sort of one large image. And here you can, if you select a frame, you can rotate it or choose a mirror image. And you'll notice under each one there's a checkbox and they're all checked. Now it may be that you don't want every frame. So if we just want this lady here, we'll uncheck the other ones. Just leave one frame checked. And once we've done that, click on scan. That will bring up the file save settings dialog again. So you can select where you're going to save the image. It's still in my scan folder. You can select the file format. And when initially I was just scanning in every image, I wanted to keep them fairly small, so I used JPEG. On this second stage, I'm concerned about quality. So I'm going to use TIFF, which is an uncompressed format. Click OK when you're ready. And then it's doing another scan. So it's now finished and we'll save file. And when we go back into the original folder, you'll see the 12 images we scanned originally using the full auto mode, they're JPEGs. And there's the one TIFF file that we've just done using the home mode. The fourth and final mode is professional mode, and this is the same basic concept as home mode. You can do a preview scan, make adjustments, and then do a final scan, but it's like home mode on steroids. There are just a lot more options. For example, there's an unsharp mask, so you can add sharpening to your images. Grain reduction, film tends to be quite grainy, especially above ISO 400. Is certainly a lot grainier than digital photography. And you can mess around with histograms and curves and tone correction. You can do quite a lot of stuff. And what's quite nice is that once you've done all your settings, you can save them. So you could have one lot of settings for one lot of negatives and another setting for another lot of negatives. That's quite a nice feature. Now, the thing about this is that personally, I've never regarded images coming out of Epson Scan as being final images. I just use Scan to digitize my negatives, and then I'll do all my final editing in Photoshop. I'm a lot more familiar with Photoshop than I am with this software. So it's a personal preference, really. It depends, you know, how much you want to do here and how much you want to do in Photoshop or any other image editing software that you might have. But I don't tend to do too much in Scan. I prefer Photoshop. Anyway, once you've selected all your options, it's then just exactly the same as home mode. Do your preview, select your format, select your folder where you want the images saved, and then it will do the final scan. Well, I hope that's been useful. If you have any comments, questions, or other feedback, please leave them below. I'm always happy to try to answer questions if I can. And happy scanning, and good luck making a digital archive from your film negatives. Thank you for watching.